Grace be unto you and peace from God the Father Almighty and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I did a lot of research into this week's gospel as I struggled a little bit with this passage and what it means to suffer or be a servant or that suffering servant. And part of this study led me to seek out different facets of servant leadership and what it truly means to be one who is serving their fellow humankind. And the definition of servant leadership, as posed by Robert Greenleaf, lists out seven characteristics of someone who exemplifies what it means to serve in this manner, which are authenticity, strong communication, integrity, compassion, empowerment, continuous improvement, and putting others first. But I believe if we look back on the life of Christ and all that he embodied as the one sent by God to come beside us in our journey, Christ lived out his life as an example of all of these traits and one that we should follow as well. There was no doubt that Jesus was authentic as he created his team of disciples through honest and open conversations by establishing trust and his ability to build influence by living out the life of one who came to serve and not compromising himself due to the powers exerted by others in not serving God. I don't see this as terribly challenging for Jesus, but I am sure he had his moments when his most trusted friends didn't or couldn't understand what he was truly doing and his mission as the Messiah for all. The true nature of Jesus' messiahship was not to conquer or overpower those around him, but to serve, and to serve in fully committing his life to the mission he was on for the salvation of humankind. And I would posit that Jesus considered himself a strong communicator, though the reaction of his disciples in comprehending his message might convey a different opinion. And in the beginning of his ministry, Jesus often spoke in parables and stories to deliver his messages of hope, love, and redemption. And these were often misunderstood by the disciples, and to be honest, are still up to interpretation this day, with countless books, commentaries, and sermons putting their own spin on what Jesus was trying to share with those on his journey. And I would like to say, though, that with as many different translations to what are found in the Bible, we are still given the good news that Jesus came to be among us and share his life so that we also could live. I think it's also a way for us to find hope in Christ as we seek out his words and find ways to weave them into our lives and find joy in any communication we have with God. My word is my bond, as first found in Shakespeare's The Merchant of Venice, is what characterizes that servant leader trait of integrity. And in a world fraught with litigation, I long for the time when a person's word or assurances held the weight of what we now rely on lawyers to discern for us. Jesus did not compromise his mission to satisfy the powerful or to cow to their whims or wishes. Jesus was focused on what he had been sent into the world to do, even with the knowledge that he was going to die on the cross. Jesus held his ground and maintain the true character of the true Messiah, not one who would trade things off for an easier way. Jesus did what Jesus said he was going to do, and nothing, not even his closest friends, would sway him from saving us. But I don't think we find a story related to Jesus where we don't find compassion for his fellow humans. Jesus heals and heals and heals. He hears the cries of the leper, the paralytic man, the demoniac, the woman at the well, the bleeding woman, and the pleas of the Roman centurion. Jesus does not deny anyone and holds true to the nature of servant. This is often challenging for the disciples as they try to protect Jesus from certain people, people who they believe don't fit the mold of needing to be with Jesus. Yet, as we heard a couple of weeks ago, Jesus welcomes everyone because he is for everyone, and no one is to be excluded. I would like to say that one of the strengths I perceive as one of Jesus' greatest is that of empowerment. Jesus does this right from the beginning as he empowers John the Baptist in his ministry, empowers simple fishermen to spread the good news, empowers those on the margins to be able to stand up and be heard, and embraces women and children into his ministry. And these were all unheard of back in the day. And again, goes to his integrity in serving those who need to be served, but also providing others with the tools to do so. Other tools, knowledge, and support for them to be successful in their ministries and outreach. Jesus affirms that he came not to be served, but to serve, and refuses to be put on that pedestal. He does not seek special benefits or honors. He's intent on putting others before himself, finding ways to improve those within his care. So much so that he's taught his disciples how to give their power away with the understanding that being a servant does not equal being powerless. And Jesus exemplifies that servant leadership perfectly. He came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. This sacrificial love is the cornerstone of our faith. And as we look to him, we are reminded that greatness is found in love and selflessness, not in power or control. Empowerment in Christ is not about climbing the social ladder. Rather, it's about embracing that call to serve. And Jesus exemplifies this servant leadership throughout his life and ultimately his sacrifice on the cross. Empowerment, then, is found in our willingness to follow his example of humility and service. Jesus turns on those powerful elite, turns them on their heels as he contrasts worldly leadership and his vision of greatness. Jesus tells us, whoever wants to become great among you must be servant of all. This is a radical redefinition of empowerment. True power comes not from domination, but from serving others. And as a follower of Christ, we are called to embody this servant heart of Jesus. This means putting others before ourselves, seeking to uplift those around us, and being willing to serve without seeking recognition. Whether it's volunteering in our community, lending a listening ear, offering support to those in need, our acts of service reflect the heart of Christ. It's not about defining who is the greatest or who has done the most in their lives. The mind of one focused on servanthood is one that steps back and does because God is in their hearts and leads every action. Those who embrace the empowerment of servanthood are ones who are focused on action as opposed to those who seek praise and accolades. Jesus affirms for the brothers, and so he does for us as well, that we will at some point share in his suffering as a result of our servant heart. We will realize the greatness of God and the gift of salvation. Now we are called to share with those who are in need, and put others ahead of our own needs. This is the true nature of power, to do as Jesus did, and use whatever gifts we have to better those who are not as fortunate. So let's strive to embody a servant-hearted attitude in all we do. When we seek to empower others, we reflect the love of Christ and build a more vibrant community of faith. May we leave here today with a renewed commitment to serve selflessly and to empower those around us. Let us pray for the courage to live out our faith through acts of service, embracing the transformative power of Christ in our lives. Jesus has empowered us with his example of servant leadership, and now is the time for action by following in his footsteps. Where will you lead to serve today?